Welcome back, everyone, to the fifth and final instalment of the Render Talk series for consumer products. Change of scenery, as you can see. We previously set it up to do Teams calls because of lockdown and everything that's happened over the past 18 months, but back in the office. This isn't going to change anything. We'll still be bringing you all the tips and tricks that you can use within NX Render. We're concluding the consumer product series with render setup and the different functions available to you within NX to create the perfect render. Before we begin, I just want to draw your attention to the Visualizing the Digital Twin webinar we hosted recently in the summer. The webinar drew on a range of topics we've already touched on throughout the course of the Render Talk series. As well as this, the webinar also focused on collaboration in virtual reality and how to create product animations. Make sure to check that out so you can learn more. Okay, right, back to the talk. So thanks again, Gavin, for jumping on. First question I want to focus on is the importance cameras played at this stage. I know this falls under the previous stage of the render process, but the presumption is that you want to place a range of cameras to provide you with few choices for the renders you're creating.
Yeah, when I'm working with it, I'll often find that when I'm at this stage, I'm pretty much ready to go to get everything done. So having all your views set up straight away will save you time. Another reason for this is also if you do design changes. So I've done a render, it's been reviewed, there's changes done to the model. I can then replicate the same view. I don't have to try and get the view again. It's all there. So the more, you know, set up all your views, and then when it comes to your final renders, you can just cycle through them as you do and create all the images from it.
And would you say it's a fairly important step to make sure that you're happy with your model at this stage before you start setting up the final renders?
Yeah, I mean, that's why we kind of using the VBOM setup when we're working. What this allows us to do all the way through, it keeps the viz data. So, you know, what we're creating all together, we can then suppress things and have things ready to go for rendering. We're not trying to render more than we need. So yeah, it is. And like using these setups that you set up earlier in the process, it speeds you up time at the end. You're not having to go through your model, turn things on and off. When you're rendering, you only want to render what you need to. There's no point in having things turned on inside that you're never going to see.
Yeah. So. Okay, that sounds great. And how do you make a final decision on the type of render that you will be creating?
So it's all based off of what's it for? What am I using the image for? Am I going to need it for a design review? So there, I could be just doing a quick image to put in front of a few people, maybe my design team, or am I going for something that's going to go in front of stakeholders? At that point, I'd want a more finalized image, maybe a bigger resolution to the image. So when I'm talking about that, the actual size of the image. And all of that takes time.
Yeah.
So depending on what you're going for, then you can sort of judge it for that. Design review between a few people, you know, relatively small image, relatively very quick turnaround. I'm going to go for something a bit bigger. Then yeah, I'm going to look at more focused on how long this is going to take and what setting I'm going to put in.
Great, sounds good. And I just want to quickly touch on GPU cards. So how important is it to have powerful GPU cards when you're creating your renders?
Well, NX Render actually it utilizes GPU over CPU, so having bigger cards speeds up the process. I know the advances in the NVIDIA cards that are made recently is, you know, the newer ones are twice as fast as the older, so the A6000s are twice as fast as the RTX 6000. So things like that do speed you up in your process, and you know, if it's a quick turnaround, then you'll be wanting to use bigger cards.
Awesome, sounds good. So I presume you'll do some tweaks to the settings for the render within NX to make sure that everything is perfect.
Yeah, so we've got the Ray Trace Studio window up, as you can see, and we've got the menu there where we can put in the settings. It's quite straightforward. We've got the render mode if you want to use PhotoReal, which we've talked about before. So that's what I would be doing at this point. The first section of this, it basically allows me to set what the dynamic render is, which is what we're looking at now. What we're actually looking at is the static image output, which is the next box down. So here I'm going to actually choose the file format, the size that I want to render out at. So this is what I was saying before about with the design review. Here I can actually input settings, and as you can see, we've got the aspect ratio, you've got a width and a height. So generally what I'll do is I'll put in what I think my final, if I'm doing it for like more of a marketing style image, you know, it'd be about 5,000 pixels. And then under that, we can just set the iterations of how many iterations I want it to use before I feel it's resolved. That all depends on the type of image you're doing. So like something like this, it actually can be like a couple of thousand. Whereas if you're doing something that's quite complex, you might need to up that a bit. And then underneath that, we actually have an area where we can do remote rendering. Mm-hmm. So what this is if you're working on a laptop or a machine that doesn't have very good cards, yeah. you can actually utilize, using Iris Server, a machine that does have good cards on it and send all that to do the processing. So it's quite a good way of working. We use it in the office and we get good results from it.
Yeah, that sounds great. Thanks very much, Gavin. So last question from me. Is there anything to consider when saving out the final image or set of images?
Yeah, I mean, this comes down to what you're doing with it afterwards. NX gives you a range of output settings, and you can also, as we're showing here, you can have with a background, without a background. Without a background allows you to basically drop it over a PowerPoint or something, and you can have text running through it. It basically gives it an alpha channel automatically. Again, it all comes down to what you're doing it for. Mm-hmm. So the smallest file size would be like a JPEG, mm-hmm. Whereas then you've got a PNG, which again will have an alpha, and then you can have the full size TIFF files. Mm-hmm. I personally will render out my final images as TIFFs,
yeah.
Just because they're better quality, there's no compression on them, and if I have an alpha with them, they'll come through. Yeah. What I also do is a little bit of a thing is I'll save one with a background, one without a background. Yeah. Just because I've always got flexibility then.
Great, sounds good. But thanks again, Gavin. That concludes the Render Talk series for consumer products. We will link you through to the first entry into the series on YouTube so you can then, you know, watch through all of the different episodes in case you missed them all. As always, massively appreciate you taking the time to watch through if you have already done so. And as always, thanks to Gavin for his expert analysis throughout the series. Appreciate it. That wraps up consumer products. But keep your eyes peeled for the next series. This is something that we want to keep doing as we move forward into the new year. So thanks again, everyone. Take care. Cheers, Gavin.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Bye.